Scream does not tell the audience the rules of horror. In the 1996 film, a series of murders plagued the town of Woodsboro. To escape the carnage for the night and ease tensions, the high school students throw a party wherein they watch horror movies. Randy, a self-professed expert on horror, halts the festivities when he realizes that the other partygoers don't know the rules to surviving a horror movie.
There are certain rules that one must abide by in order to successfully survive a horror movie.
Randy says that only virgins will survive and that only those who abstain from getting drunk or high will survive. What Randy is describing is a pattern that filmmakers, consciously or unconsciously, tend to follow when crafting a movie like Scream. A movie is influenced by the society that creates it and crafted for the society that will watch it. Not in terms of effectively mirroring our circumstances, but in displaying what society values. Virginity, chastity, modesty. These Puritan conservative values are praised by the society that made movies like Halloween and Friday the 13th. In the former, not only is a woman slain immediately after being intimate with her boyfriend, but it happens in the very bed where she did it. In the latter, the entire rampage takes place due to counselors sneaking off to be with each other while Jason Voorhees drowned. These movies are undoubtedly influenced by the real-world false dichotomy of categorizing women into two boxes. Either the pure Madonna or the insatiable tramp who is both sought after and frowned upon by the same men. This pattern reoccurs in these movies with such frequency that scores of books and academic papers have been written about it. Randy is correct in understanding that life or death within horror movies is often a value judgment and related to sin, but he is incorrect in the specifics, because what he tells the party guests are not the rules of horror, but the rules of slasher movies, a subgenre of horror movies. Different subgenres have different values, different sins that they highlight. A slasher movie generally features a lone killer, young, mostly women victims who are taken out one by one, and a survivor, almost always a woman who did not indulge herself, and who guarded her virginity. Slasher movies can deviate from this pattern a little and still be slasher movies. Scream, for example, features a pair of killers instead of one, older men are killed with about as much frequency as young women, and there are multiple survivors living in various degrees of sin. Randy survives Scream despite drinking alcohol. Sydney survives despite losing her virginity to Billy. Slasher movies that purposefully deviate from established patterns do so in recognition of those patterns nonetheless, subverting the expectations of the audience. Scream and other slashers that deviate from established patterns are still recognizably slasher movies. Few slasher movies deviate as much as Scream, but that is only because Scream is meant as a send-up of the subgenre. Although inaccurate, it makes sense that the dialogue in this scene conflates horror movies with the slasher subgenre. In the 1980s and early 90s, slashers were the dominant and most lucrative subgenre of horror in the United States. So much, in fact, that when the words horror movie were uttered during that period, popular slasher franchises like A Nightmare on Elm Street would come to mind more often than, say, The Fog or Videodrome. Slasher movies were inexpensive to produce and yielded big returns at the box office. Low risk, high reward. Also, Randy's famous speech would have been awkward if he had said, "There are certain rules you must abide by in order to survive a horror movie, specifically the slasher subgenre, as horror has a diversity of patterns and influences. Hey, where are you going?" Nevertheless, the inaccuracy begs for correction and examination. Subgenres of horror have their own patterns, and each entry into the subgenre reveals what the society that created it values and devalues. It is not a coincidence that various horror subgenres made in the Western world utilize sin as its values barometer, even if the patterns are different. Gothic horror is defined by its romanticism, forbidden sensuality, and by its setting, taking place before the 20th century and in castles, remote hamlets, or decaying, haunted mansions. Gothic horror movies often place sin center stage, sometimes due to being adaptations of novels prior to what we might consider the modern world, and sometimes due to the ubiquity of purity and sin being what the Western world values and devalues respectively. In various adaptations of Frankenstein, Victor Frankenstein plays God, resurrecting the dead, unnaturally reanimating what was naturally taken. The novel leaves the method vague, but in the most famous adaptation, Frankenstein harnesses a storm, which has its own biblical connections, to give life to his creation. For this indiscretion, this affront to God, both he and others around him are punished. His hubris in transcending his human restrictions and meddling in God's domain cost him greatly.
In the name of God, now I know what it feels like to be God.
Adaptations of Dracula, particularly the 1992 adaptation, show Dracula's descent into inhumanity correlated with the rejection of God, specifically God as depicted within Christianity. The dichotomy of the pure woman and the promiscuous woman often comes into play within gothic horror as much as slashers, but rather than this dichotomy portrayed as only implicitly having to do with Christian morality, gothic horror set during more modest eras can more explicitly reference this. Lucy, who is portrayed as promiscuous, is transformed into a monster that needs to be slain through the power of the cross. Mina, who is chaste until her marriage to Jonathan, survives Dracula despite her temptations. Gothic horror antagonists are often those that Christian morality posits as being in direct competition with God, or an affront to God, such as witches and the devil himself. So, how does one survive a gothic horror movie, Randy? Surviving a gothic horror movie is connected with abstinence and a devotion to God. Not always, as there are variations within any subgenre, but often. Mina survives. Lucy does not. Sin, as both the moral barometer and arbiter of survival, exists in gothic horror movies as much as slashers, but in the former, belief in God and Christian morality are also components. Faith cannot stop Michael Myers, but it can and will stop Dracula. This overlaps with the broader supernatural horror subgenre. Supernatural horror is often defined by the antagonist. Spirits, demons, devils, supernatural entities that haunt the protagonist. If the supernatural horror movie is made in the Western world due to Christianity being the most common religion, the supernatural elements are often explained through Christianity or defeated through Christianity. Often, the haunting visited upon our characters is related to sin or not showing proper respect to God. In Poltergeist, when the father learns that the cemetery had been moved, he calls it sacrilegious. He later discovers that the headstones were moved, but the bodies remained under his house. The antagonist is explained through religion, through sin. The worst ghost in the house is described as the beast, which is a reference to the devil or demons. In The Exorcist, the demon possessing Reagan is defeated through religion, through the expulsion of sin.
The power of Christ compels you! That the power of Christ compels you!
Horror movies show what the society that creates them values and devalues. It values faith, and it devalues a lack of faith. Father Karras' greatest obstacle in The Exorcist is not Pazuzu, but his own lost faith, which he struggles to overcome throughout the film. In the end, he believes again, and sacrifices himself to save Reagan. At a glance, Karras dying despite his faith conflicts with the connection between values and survival, but this is a different kind of survival, a spiritual survival. What greater value is there for a Catholic than martyrdom? Surviving a supernatural horror film is best achieved by trusting Christians. What about secular horror subgenres? What are the secular values they espouse? Zombie horror, despite the appearance of being supernatural, takes a more secular route. Often the cause of the zombie apocalypse is either completely unexplained or is caused by humankind making a simple mistake. Dawn of the Dead has a line about no room left in hell that touches on a spiritual explanation for what is happening, but nothing ever comes of it, and it exists largely in isolation in this subgenre. The solution to the zombies is more humanist than in other horror subgenres, because the solution is cooperation. The zombies are many, but the humans can use weapons, can strategize, can think. It is in their cooperation, their humanity, that allows them to live. When cooperation fails, that is when the humans are most vulnerable to the zombies. When cooperation succeeds, that is when the humans are strongest against the zombies. Surviving a zombie movie is unlike some other horror subgenres because all that is necessary is humanity. Sci-fi horror often values human knowledge over human ignorance. It also values the aforementioned human cooperation. In Alien, Ripley states that the xenomorph must not be brought on board because it will almost certainly endanger the entire crew. They ignore her warning and the crew is lost, except for Ripley, the only crew member who recognized the danger. In The Thing, paranoia and lack of cooperation eventually leads the shape-changing alien to run amok. Surviving sci-fi horror is a matter of intelligence and cooperation. In a sense, both Alien and The Thing operate much like slasher movies. An unstoppable foe who picks everyone off one by one until there is only a sole survivor. We don't find out who will be the sole survivor in The Thing, but the pattern is still there. Remember, a slasher movie can deviate from a pattern a little and still be recognizable as a slasher movie. So, is Alien a slasher movie if it follows the structure of a slasher movie? I would say there is not enough family resemblance, and not only because of its setting and tone. Alien does not resemble a slasher movie because of what it values. The real rule of horror, the real way to survive a horror movie, is to find out what kind of horror movie you're in. People define these horror subgenres by so many features, their setting, the monster, but these subgenres are perhaps most recognizable in what they value, what they portray as sin.
Someone has taken their love of fear one step too far.
We know you're not the killer.
Solving this mystery...
Everybody's a suspect!
...is going to be murder.
Who are you?
The question is, where am I? We all go a little mad sometimes.